goodness with care from our villages Arokya milk.
Hi everyone, welcome to episode 1 of Mahabharata with Anuja. Now, Vedavyasa's immortal epic, the Mahabharata, is not just one of the best stories ever told, it is also extremely complicated. The format Vedavyasa used was every story will have a story behind it, and every backstory will also have a backstory. So we have thousands of characters and many, many, many stories. It is believed that nobody can interpret the Mahabharata in its entirety. So there will always be something new you will learn every time you read the Mahabharata or hear the story. They say entire lifetimes aren't enough. But I hope to do the best I can to explain and simplify the story for you. Let's start at the very beginning. As the song goes, it's a very good place to start. Now, Vedavyasa was supposed to have composed this entire epic entirely in his mind. And when he had done this, they say that he worshipped Brahma and sought his help. Brahma very graciously appeared before him, and when Vedavyasa told him that he'd composed this amazing poem, this epic poem, Brahma advised him to propitiate Lord Ganesha and to ask his help as the divine scribe to set it down for posterity. And Vedavyasa took this advice and he worshipped Ganesha, who also appeared before him, and Vedavyasa requested him to write down the story so that it can be preserved for the rest of time. Ganesha agreed, but there was one condition. Ganesha told Vyasa, once I start writing, I will not stop. Once I stop, I will not pick up my quill again. Vedavyasa agreed, but he placed a condition of his own. He said, I will keep on narrating the story, but you have to understand everything you put down. And the two of them shook on it in a manner of speaking, and they got started on this magnum opus. It's supposed to have gone on for many, many years. Vedavyasa would keep narrating and Ganesha would keep writing very fast. And Vedavyasa therefore composed some extremely complicated stanzas, and Ganesha would slow down in order to understand its meaning and also to savor the story, which was so incredibly beautiful. And the two great legends, they kept at it for a long time, and finally the entire Mahabharata was set down. And both of them were immensely satisfied when this happened, and Ganesha is supposed to have blessed the Mahabharata. He said that the Mahabharata will survive as long as the mountains stand and as long as the rivers flow. And having concluded their business to their mutual satisfaction, both of them went on their way. And legend has it that Vedavyasa first shared this version of the Mahabharata with his son, sage Shuka. And later he told this story to his disciples as well. It was sage Shuka who first shared the stories with the Gandharvas, the Rakshasas and the Yakshas. And it was sage Narada, the famous troublemaker and devotee of Lord Vishnu, who shared the Mahabharata with the celestials, Indra and all the immortals. Now I'm going to tell you the story of how it was shared with the human beings, with the mortals, with us. It was shared by Vedavyasa's foremost disciple, sage Vaishampayana, at a very incredible snake sacrifice. And I'm going to tell you how it all went down. Now, King Janamejaya, he was the king of Hastinapura, okay, and he belonged to a very, very illustrious lineage. He was Arjuna's great-grandson. His grandfather was Abhimanyu, a hero who is beloved to Indians everywhere. His father's name was Parikshit, and Parikshit also was a very special baby because he was the sole surviving heir of the Pandavas. And they say that Lord Krishna had saved his life while he was a newborn infant. Now, Janamejaya did not know any of his illustrious ancestors personally. He'd lost his father at a very young age, and he'd been a ward of the court. And when he reached his majority, he'd been placed on the throne. He did not know much about the past. His ministers had made sure about it because there were some traumatic secrets there. As a king, Janamejaya was very, very good. He was just and fair, and he was very strong also, a very brave warrior. And everybody was very, very happy with him. And things were going on like this. But one day, he had a visit from a very important character. His name was Sage Uttanka. And Sage Uttanka told him all about his father's tragic, extremely unfortunate death. And I'm going to share that story with you now. Now it so happened that King Parikshit, who was also a very, very good king, had been hunting one day just to relax, I guess it was what they all did. And he'd gone hunting and he'd wounded this deer. And he was a bit irritated because the deer would be in a lot of pain, and Dharma dictated that he go after it and give it a merciful release. So he was chasing this deer, but for some reason he just could not catch up with this deer. He ran deeper and deeper into the forest. He got separated from all his companions. He was extremely hungry, thirsty, and really tired. And in this state of mind, he entered the ashram of Sage Shamika. He saw this man sitting there with his eyes open, and he went up to him and he said, "Hi, could I have some water to drink, and could you tell me if you saw a deer go this side?" The sage did not reply at all. He'd taken a vow of silence, but the king did not know that, and he was too bad-tempered to care at that moment. So he just started grumbling to himself. He looked around, he found some water, helped himself, and then as fate would have it, he saw a dead serpent lying over there. And then using his bow, he picked it up and he placed it on the shoulders of this sage, and then he walked away. Even as he was leaving, he knew he'd done something really wrong, but there was no going back, so he just returned to his kingdom. Meanwhile, all the inhabitants of the forest, they heard what happened to Sage Shamika, and the news went to his son. The son's name is Shringan. And Shringan was as noble as his father, but was very bad-tempered, and when he heard that his father had been insulted in this way, he just could not stand it, and he cursed King Parikshit. He said, "The king is unworthy. He insulted my father like this, and so exactly 7 days from now, he will lose his life. Bound by the power of my curse, King Takshaka, the king of serpents, will kill this unworthy king." And it was a terrible curse, and everybody was shocked. And even Sage Shamika, he told his son, "You've been very, very hasty." King Parikshit, in a moment, it was a momentary lapse of judgment. And he doesn't deserve such a severe punishment. He's been good to all of us. There's peace in the kingdom, and we can all do our business in quiet satisfaction. So it's really very harsh. And Shringan agreed, but he said, "I cannot take back my curse. But since you feel so strongly about it, I will send a fair warning to the king." And a messenger was sent to King Parikshit with these very sad tidings. And when the king heard it, on the advice of his ministers, he built himself this impenetrable fortress, and he placed himself inside. Even the air wasn't allowed to enter without, you know, being subject to scrutiny by his ministers, and he conducted his business from there. Now, it so happened that King Takshaka was making his way towards the king, and there were also many sages and healers who wanted to offer their services in the event of a snake bite. The leading practitioner of this art was Sage Kashyapa, and even the most powerful of poison could be countered by him, and he decided to go and offer his services to King Parikshit. Takshaka saw him on the way, and he just spoke to the sage. He said, "I don't think it's possible for you to do this. Where King Takshaka is concerned, his poison is the most potent. Why don't you give me a little sample of what you can do?" And they say Takshaka, buried his fangs into a large banyan tree out there, which immediately turned to ash because the poison was so strong out there. And Kashyapa did not even blink. He applied his magic arts, and the tree rose majestic and fine as it was. And Takshaka immediately said, "You know about the curse. You know I'm honor bound to do this. So why do you want to go there and undo my effects? What do you seek?" Kashyapa said he's a good king. I wanted to save him, and I was also hoping to be richly compensated for my services. He was not really a very greedy man or anything, but this is what he said. And Takshaka said, I will give you more than what King Parikshit is capable of giving you. Please leave. And Kashyapa sat down for a minute. He meditated, and he decided that King Takshaka was right. The will of fate had to be carried on, and he agreed very graciously, and he left that spot. And meanwhile, 7 days had almost passed. The sun was close to setting, and King Parikshit was starting to feel very relaxed. He felt a little bit silly. He thought they'd made too big a deal about this, and he was starting to drop his guard. At that point, some merchants arrived that side, and they bought him a basket of fruit. And they offered it to the king, and he was hungry, and he grabbed this ripe looking fruit, and Takshaka was concealed inside as a worm. He saw this worm and he laughed. He said, I was expecting a mighty serpent and I get this little thing. And he just brought it close to his neck like that as a joke. And Takshaka emerged and sank his fangs into his neck, and the king passed away at once. And this tragic story was told to Janamejaya by sage Utanka. And Janamejaya was very, very angry, not with the sages who'd cursed his father, but he directed his anger at Takshaka. He said, Takshaka could have at least allowed Kashyapa to revive my father. He's a very spiteful, evil king, and I will bring about his death. And he consulted with sage Utanka, who recommended that he perform the serpent sacrifice. Now, this was a sacrifice which would take about 12 years, and this sacrifice would claim the lives of all the serpents. Now, why did Utanka do this? Why did he come and get this thing, this chain started? There's a little story there also. Utanka had a little grievance with King Takshaka. Now, Utanka, as a youngster, he had just completed his training under Guru Veda, and he had to pay his Guru Dakshina. The sage told him, I don't need anything. You've been a very good pupil to me, but do ask my wife if she has any request. If you fulfill that, I will consider your Guru Dakshina as having been paid. Now, Utanka, very dutifully, he approached the sage's wife, and she told him, there's a queen who possesses a pair of celestial earrings. It's very dear to me. Please go get it. It has magic properties, and my husband's conducting a sacrifice. I want to wear it for that. If you don't come back on time, you will suffer the consequences. But if you fulfill this, I'm sure you'll be very, very blessed. And so basically, Utanka had a deadline. He had to obtain these earrings and bring it back. So he was on his way. In those days, traveling was a big deal, right? So he was making his way towards this queen, and after a lot of adventures and after a lot of persuasion, he managed to make the queen part with her earrings. And she warned him. She said, King Takshaka, he belongs to the serpent race. He's a Naga, and he's always wanted these earrings of mine. He will try to steal it from you. So Utanka decided that he'll be careful. But despite his efforts, Takshaka was very wily, and he managed to steal these earrings. And when Utanka gave chase, he just disappeared underground like that. And Utanka was not one to give up, so he started digging with a stick. And as you can imagine, it took a long time. He made very little progress. And they say Indra felt sorry for him, and he hurled his thunderbolt to open a passage for him to follow. And Utanka made his way to the kingdom of Nagas. He saw many, many marvels, and he realized that they were masters in the magical arts, and they could shift their shapes at will, take the form of anyone they wanted. It was an amazing magical race, this Naga race. And it took a lot of effort again, and he had to ask Lord Agni to help him. And Agni threatened to, you know, consume the whole kingdom of the Nagas with flames. And only then King Takshaka came and returned those earrings. So Utanka got the earrings, and somehow he borrowed a horse from Agni, and he made it back on time. And he gave it to his guru's wife just before she pronounced a curse on him. And she said, you cut it very close, but thank you, you did it. And she sent him on his way. And he was very shaken by this episode, and he felt King Takshaka was to blame. He said, this king has so much power and he's not worthy of it. I'll wait, and I'm going to have my revenge against this king. Which is why he spoke to King Janamejaya and convinced him to perform this serpent sacrifice. And there's another curse involved here. In all these stories, there are plenty of curses about how the snakes were almost completely annihilated. They almost reached that point of extinction. And the reason is that in a very ancient time, they would have been cursed by Kadru, the primordial mother of the serpents. She would have cursed them for disobeying her when she tried to cheat her sister and enslave her. That's a long story for another day. But basically, when the snakes were cursed like this, initially the Devas had been very happy that their rivals had been cursed. But even they appealed to Brahma and they said that it's very tragic if an entire race is completely exterminated like this. And Brahma said Kadru's curse will come true when King Janamejaya performs the snake sacrifice. But the snakes will be saved, not all of them will die. There was a very special boy named Astika. He would be born to a serpent princess and a sage, and this Astika, he said, would serve the serpents. And in due course, Janamejaya started performing the snake sacrifice. All the foremost sages were there. Lots of snakes were destroyed over the period of 12 years, and finally Astika came, required a boon from the king, and he managed to save the serpents, including Takshaka. And it was at this snake sacrifice that Vedavyasa appeared with all his disciples. And when Janamejaya saw him, he said, "Please tell me all about my ancestors. I want to know about Arjuna and his brothers. I want to know about Krishna. Please tell me about my grandfather Abhimanyu, my father Parikshit. Tell me about all of them." And Vedavyasa very graciously agreed, and he asked his disciple Vaishampayana to share the story, and it was told over 12 years. And on hearing the story, there was a sage in the audience. His name is Sage Shutta, and he told this version of the story to a huge gathering at a forest called Naimisha. And legend has it that it is this version which has trickled down to us. That concludes episode 1. Please do hit like and share, and I would like to hear your thoughts in the comments section. I will see you soon, and I'm going to tell you a story about one of the pillars of the Mahabharata, who was born to a river goddess dear to all of us. So stay tuned, I'll see you soon. Thank you very much.
Goodness with care. From our villages, Arokya Milk.